I came up to the grist mill one day, and I thought that this area, it didn't look that great because the pond was looking nice, the grist mill was looking nice, and I figured that this area needed to be nice too. It was all weeds, poison ivy when I first came here, and I wanted to make it look beautiful, and so I started thinking of what I could do with it. So the original plan was just to clean this area up and put the wood chips down, and that was the project. But then I was starting to talk to Mr. DeSorger, and he came up with the idea that maybe we should commemorate our missing in action soldiers with a memorial bench in this area now that I've already cleaned up this area. So we ended up putting these pavers in, and then we added the bench, and that's how the project ended up. I had to get the project approved by my troop, so I had to present my workbook to the troop, present what I was gonna do. Then I had to go to the district to have the Seven Rivers District of the Boy Scouts approve my project. But because we are within 100 yards of wetlands, I had to have the Medfield Conservation Commission give me a permit, so I had to present my project at the one of the Conservation Commission meetings also. At first, I did not think it was that going to be that involved, because I just thought I was going to be cleaning up the area, putting wood chips down, and a story. But as I kept going through the project, more and more was added, and it came out to be a much better project than I had expected it to be. The family of Mr. MacKeachie personally thanked me for what I did. It was really nice that the Warner family was able to be here in person. You could tell the brother and the sister were very appreciative of what I've done, and it was really nice to know that the families appreciated what I did for their family member. I would have thanked them also for their service if they were not missing in action. If they did come back to Medfield and they were around, I would have definitely thanked them for their service for our country.
On behalf of the Kingsbury Pond Grist Mill Committee, thank you for joining us as we commemorate two brave citizens of our town and dedicate this site to their memory. Welcome, honored guests, Father John Colley from St. Edward Parish, members of the Werner family, State Representative Garlick, Selectmen Peterson, Marcucci, and Murby, Town Administrator Sullivan, Chief Meany, thank you for helping with public safety, Ron Griffin, Medfield Veteran Services Officer, Tyler Hatch, Eagle Scout candidate, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, Cub Scouts, and Brownies, members of the Medfield High School Band and Chorus, and fellow citizens. We gather here at Kingsbury Pond today to remember citizens of our town who left Medfield to serve our country during times of conflict, never to return, their final whereabouts unknown. Specifically, we honor two of our fellow townspeople, Staff Sergeant Richard Werner and Colonel Douglas MacKeachie, who are still, after more than 70 years, missing in action. Medfield has a long tradition of military service, predating the birth of our country. Over the decades and centuries, many Medfield citizens have made sacrifices to ensure our freedom, in some cases, paying the ultimate price. As heirs to Medfield's proud legacy, it is our duty to ensure that they and their stories are not forgotten, but rather live on to inspire future generations and remind us of the price that has been paid for the freedom and liberties that we enjoy. In an age of an all-volunteer military service where it falls to less than 1% of the US population to defend our country, it can be difficult for those of us who were not called on or chose not to serve, to even conceive of times when virtually all able-bodied citizens were expected to answer the call of duty in times of war. During World War II, our greatest generation responded to that call with selflessness, perhaps a sense of adventure, but ultimately an obligation to preserve the freedom that their forefathers had sacrificed to win and protect. Whether they were just setting out on their adult lives or were in the midst of promising careers, they all left behind family, friends, and a way of life. Some never returned, and some were lost to us forever, classified as missing in action or prisoners of war. To their memory, we dedicate one of the most cherished settings of our town so that all who come here to enjoy the peace and serenity it provides may also reflect on the sacrifices that have made it possible. Father Colity, would you offer a blessing to begin our ceremony?
And let us pray. All-loving and merciful God, we gather this day to honor the memory of Richard and Douglas, who gave their lives in the cause of freedom. We thank you for granting them and so many others the willingness and courage to answer the call of the country in a time of great need and peril. We mourn their loss and regret that their final resting places are known to you alone. But today, as we dedicate this site, we promise to remember them and others still missing in action in our thoughts and in our prayers. May this site remind those who visit here that there is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends and for one's country. May they never be forgotten. May you grant peace to those family members and friends of Richard and Douglas who still mourn their loss. And may Richard and Douglas be found at peace and at rest in that eternal home we call heaven. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Next, Matthew McCrory of Medfield High School will sing America the Beautiful while the Boy Scouts of Troop 89 fold the flags covering the memorial bench and present them to the Werner family and the town of Medfield. Feel free, please, to join Matthew in singing.
Skies for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains, majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Thank you. Richard Chester Werner grew up on 67 Harding Street, the son of Grace and Chester Werner. As a child, he was a victim of polio, but with the loving care of his parents, he was able to defeat the disease, though it left him with one leg shorter than the other and numbness in his toes. In 1941, Richard graduated from Medfield High School. After the attack on Pearl Harbor later that same year, he joined the Medfield unit of the Massachusetts State Guard. On February 5th, 1943, he enlisted in the Army Air Corps. When Army doctors discovered the damage polio had done to his feet, they were hesitant to accept him. Richard convinced them that he did not need two good feet to fly. By May of 1944, he was a staff sergeant manning a turret gun above a B-24 Liberator. On May 22nd, Richard's plane departed Toretto Airfield in southern Italy on a bombing mission in Piombino, Italy. Flying through the enemy fire, the plane developed mechanical problems and was last seen heading towards Corsica. The nearest plane on the squadron reported that the plane seemed to lose its number one engine, began losing altitude, dropped its gear, then dove out of formation, apparently still under the control of the pilots. On June 3rd, 1944, exactly 73 years ago today, the the Werner family received a telegraph informing them that the Secretary of War expresses his deep regrets that their son, Staff Sergeant Richard C. Werner, had been reported missing in action since May 22nd over Italy. Major General Twining of the Army Air Force wrote to the family 4 days later, confirming the notification of the War Department. The letter conveyed that the plane, while en route to the target site, developed mechanical trouble and was last seen heading for the northern Italian coast, preparing for an emergency landing. It continued that some of the crew may eventually be heard from as prisoners of war. However, unless until actual confirmation received, there is little that we can do but wait and hope for the best. No confirmation or sighting ever came, and Richard and his crewmates were never seen again. Richard Werner was posthumously awarded the Purple Heart. On Memorial Day 1944, the intersection of West Mill and Harding Streets was dedicated to Richard C. Werner Square, with over 100 veterans, family members, and friends looking on. Richard would have turned 95 years old on August 28, 2017.
Thank you, Tyler. Next, Ron Griffin, Medfield's Veteran Services Officer, will offer a tribute to Colonel Douglas MacKeachie. Ron, working with Richard DeSorger, discovered and researched Colonel MacKeachie's story.
It's my honor to speak with you today about Colonel MacKeachie. So my name is Ron Griffin. I am currently the town's Veteran Service Officer. I am a member of the Committee to Study Memorials, and I am a member of the American Legion. Much of what Tyler and I have to say today is the fruits of historical research conducted by many, but especially preserved through the efforts of town historian Richard DeSorger. I'd first like to draw your attention to the town's POW/MIA chair, which normally resides at Town Hall, but can be used at any event. This chair is the icon of all those POWs and MIAs like Douglas MacKeachie and Richard Werner. The empty chair symbolizes their absence. As we reflect back on World War II, Medfield had about 380 of its citizens serve, while only 370 returned. Of the 10 who did not return, 2 have unknown but presumed fates. Both of Medfield's World War II MIAs were lost while flying on a B-24 Liberator. This four-engine bomber sometimes is configured as a C-87 cargo plane transporting people and cargo. Death by any form is tragic for the grieving family, but when a death is presumed without confirmation, it seems especially cruel. Both families endured the probable grief that their loved one was dead, while embracing the hope of a miracle survival. There are many examples of other families whose prayers were answered when their loved one somehow defied death and miraculously survived. For the Werner and the MacKeachie family, that was not to occur. The family's ordeal to eventually accept death without confirmation is most exasperating and certainly lengthens the grieving process. Slowly and finally, hope fades from each family member, and then memories begin to erode. This becomes our purpose and resolve to create places where their lives and sacrifice can be remembered through the generations. Douglas C. MacKeachie was perhaps the oldest at age 42 and the highest ranking serviceman, full colonel, of Medfield's 380 citizens who served. Although born in Brooklyn, he grew up in Ridgewood, New Jersey. where he was on several team sports in high school and was editor of the school newspaper. After graduation from high school, he spent the next 4 years at Colgate, earning his degree in 1921. Douglas began working for the Great Atlantic Pacific and Tea Company, otherwise known as A&P. A&P then was the largest food grocery retailer in the United States. It was the Walmart before Walmart. He climbed the corporate ladder and eventually became vice president of the New England division of A&P and moved to New England and Medfield. Douglas was not in store management, but he headed its purchasing division that acquired all the product that was sold in their stores. He and his wife Martha, along with their daughter Nancy, moved to Medfield and bought the Henry Adams House on 72 Elm Street. In 1940, President Roosevelt signed into law the Training and Service Act. This was the first peacetime conscription in the United States history. This Selective Service Act required that men who had reached their 21st birthday but had not yet reached their 36th birthday register with the local draft boards. This same act also created the Office of Production Management to coordinate the manufacturing of supplies that these soldiers would need to carry out the war effort. The government recruited or borrowed leaders in the civilian industry to help develop the programs to support that effort. That resulted in places like Singer Sewing Machine being converted to for the production of the Norden bomb sights. The armies of the United States would need food, supplies, and armaments. Douglas became the OMB's first deputy director of purchasing and went to Washington, D.C. to coordinate placement of all major defense orders and contracts. After the attack of Pearl Harbor, America entered the war in Europe as well as the war in the Pacific. The military now headed the OMB, and Douglas MacKeachie was inducted as a full colonel into the United States Army. Both the U.S. and Great Britain knew their success required the pooling of their efforts and resources, not just militarily, but logistically. President Roosevelt and Prime Minister Churchill signed into agreement the entire munitions resources would deem to be common, a common pool, about which the fullest information would be exchanged. Colonel MacKeachie was dispatched to London in January of 1942 as one of the four U.S. representatives in the Combined Munitions Assignment Board. This board aided in achieving effective pooling of British and American munitions, such as bullets, bombs, explosives, grenades, gunpowder, shells, and torpedoes. On January 17, 1943, Douglas aboarded a C-87 Liberate Express, returning back to America to visit home and then attend a joint meeting of the Combined Munitions Assignments Board in Washington, D.C. There were 23 other souls aboard. The safest route in the winter back from Britain is through West Africa and then on to Brazil. The plane never arrived in Brazil. It is theorized that the plane went down either due to airplane malfunction or was shot down by a Nazi submarine. Some weeks later, one life raft was found at sea by the USS Kearney, and then another washed ashore on Ponta Negra Beach in Natal, Brazil. It is possible that there were other life rafts, but they were never found. Each life raft had a number of life jackets aboard and one dead body. Probably, as each survivor died, their body was buried at sea, with no one being left to bury the last survivor in the raft. In the Ponta Negra Beach lifecraft, 6 life vests were found. The raft contained minimal supplies, indicating that the survivors were rushed to get into the life rafts and only carried with them what might normally be found in their pockets. In fact, some of the items included the American Express traveler's checks with Colonel MacKeachie's signature on them, as well as Eagle rank insignia shaped to be used as a fish hook. Back in Medfield, his wife Martha and young daughter Nancy had endured a year of fear that the Nazi bombings over Britain might find their way to their loved one. They became very excited that he was on his way home. When they received the news that the flight did not arrive in Brazil, they prayed for those searching the oceans that he would be found and rescued. Later, when news arrived that a raft was found with his belongings in it, they again prayed, and perhaps the Nazis found the raft and, realizing his high rank, took him as a POW. Weeks turned into months, and reality crept into their hope. Finally, the decision to move forward with their lives required leaving Medfield. The youngest daughter, Nancy, grew up and married, ending the MacKeachie legacy while starting a new generation of Hagans. She had 3 children, Chris, Steve, and Linder, who lived in Florida, Texas, and California. They grew up never knowing there was a little town in Massachusetts who continued to honor and remember their grandfather. Recently, I was able to locate and contact Colonel MacKeachie's grandchildren. While none of them could make the trip for this dedication, they asked that I read a note of appreciation. Colonel Douglas MacKeachie is recognized and honored by his family, past and present, as a respectable veteran of World War II. He is remembered for his successes earned in life, his service to our country, and his genetic footprint, which has been part of the foundation of our present family. Because his only daughter, our mother and grandmother, was young at the time of his death, we did not know him in person, and much of his life continues to remain unknown. However, his spirit continues to be remembered and lived out through his future generations. We wish to extend a special thank you to Eagle Scout candidate Tyler Hatch. Also thanks to Ron Griffin, Medfield's veteran service officer, for sharing a part of history within our family that remains somewhat of a mystery, and we are forever grateful. Kind regards, the Hagans. I would like to close by reading a letter from President Franklin Roosevelt to the MacKeachie family. He stands in the unbroken line of patriots who have dared to die that freedom might live and grow and increase its blessings. Freedom lives, and through it, he lives in a way that humbles the undertaking of most men. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. Finally, we ask that you join together in a moment of silence and reflection as musicians for the Medfield High School Jazz Ensemble play Taps. Specifically, that would be Justin Lakis. Thank you. Thank you, Justin. That concludes our ceremony today. Before we leave to process back to St. Edward's, I did want to acknowledge someone who isn't here today but wanted to be. Richard DeSorger has been mentioned several times during the ceremony. Richard has been an invaluable asset to the town over the years as town historian, beloved teacher. He is in the process of moving to the Cape. Bittersweet. We will miss him dearly. But I did want to acknowledge Richard's talent over the years to bring the history of Medfield, that's 300 plus years, to life. The inspiration for this memorial project actually came from Richard's This Old Town column, which is published in the Hometown Weekly newspaper. So he has a way of bringing past events to life in a way that inspires people, and he's done that for generations of school children who were fortunate to have him at Medfield High, but also the entire community of Medfield. So Richard, hopefully you're watching this on TV and you caught that. So.
On behalf of the Medfield Grist Mill Committee, I really want to thank you all for being here. We're humbled at your presence. The town is on bended knee for the service that all people that protect this country have given. We are, I am the crossover from a memorial service to a celebration of life. I'm sure these two gentlemen would have appreciated a good march going back and a good entertainment and good friends and good family. We're here to memorialize these two gentlemen, but I'm here to tell you that they're here. They're in this town, they're in this tree, in the trees, they're behind the trees, they're on the bench. Please come back and visit anytime. This property is owned by the town of Medfield, so in fact you own it. Please come back and enjoy this nice spot, this slice of paradise. Thank you very much for all coming. We were smart enough as a group to plan cake on the other end, so encourage people to come back. Thank you.
One more thing, a special treat on our procession back. We're going to be led by Medfield High School's award-winning jazz ensemble playing New Orleans style second line. Take it away, Medfield.